Word. By the way, I've completed the house moving project, as you probably noticed, and I now have my fast internet back, so I'm attending to a backlog of shit at the moment, which I will endeavor to get around to, including Patreon rewards. There are several $25 pledges to whom I owe a personalized cartoon sketch. I haven't forgotten you, but please remind me who you are, just in case I have. Send me a message on Patreon or something. There are many $5 and $10 pledges who are free to specify a word or sentence, respectively, that they'd like me to say in a video. It can be in the form of a shill, if you like, for a website or a channel. That's permitted and even encouraged. If you give me $10, the least I can do is shill for your channel if you'd want me to, in one sentence or less, within reason. Or you can just maybe say something daft like, "Hi, I'm Mike, I'm a fat wanker and I think women are gay, dirt." My challenge is to insert your word or sentence incognito somewhere where it's ironically funny or something. Many of you have pledged the necessary amount and are yet to nominate a word or sentence. Please do, if and whenever you're ready. There's still a couple outstanding, I think. Again, please remind me if you're listening, because I've definitely lost track of some shit here and there. And there's one guy who has a song coming for the $50 pledge. He's selected a song for me to cover, and it's awesome. Coming soon, or at some point, whenever re-lyrical inspiration strikes me. All right, service announcement over. Let's do a video. We've almost finished the project, the advanced answers for anti-SJWs series. Ass, for short. We've got one more contender to go. Just one, unless I feel like doing Roland's in the bonus round, and I predict I will not feel like that. So, ranting feminist it is. Let's have a look at your videos. See if anything looks respond-to-able. My word, this is pink. Okay, I could see where you're defying the tropes, though, because it's blue as well. You can be clad head to toe in pastel pink, but as long as your hair is baby blue, you don't fit into any stereotype. Right. Speaking of which, you've insinuated right there in this thumbnail that feminists have blue hair and anti-feminists have blonde hair. Or at least that feminists dye their hair into colours that only exist in tropical parrots and poisonous frogs, and anti-feminists only dye it in colours that appear naturally in hominids, if they dye it at all. Now, models and actors and cosplayers and performing artists of all kinds have been dyeing their hair exotic colours for a jolly long time now, and that makes perfect sense because it's their job to attract attention. Getting eyes on you and keeping them on you is how you put food on the table if you're in one of these occupations. So quite why feminists do it is something of a mystery, because they're obviously not doing it for the attention. Attention-seeking pro bono. Feminists would never do that. No. They have to dye their hair blue and look pretty and exotic because it's what's demanded of them by the patriarchy. See, feminists are just doing what men tell them because they can't help it. Whereas anti-feminists don't. They just do what they feel like doing. It's not going well, is it? And we're how many seconds in? Oh, zero. We haven't even played any videos yet, and you're already fucking shit up. I wonder how far I could get just doing this. Is it not even watching the videos? Just judging books by their covers, as it were. A shallow exercise, you might call it, but at least it's different. Sexism in Media, Episode 1. Is it sexism in media what all of your videos are about? It's what most of my videos are about at this point. Some kind of ism in some kind of media. I mean, if you're not an on-the-spot reporter live at the scene of something, then all you can do is report on what you're seeing in the media available to you. And if it doesn't involve sexism, then it's none of feminism's business by definition, and you're called ranting feminist. So all your videos are about sexism in media, but you've only just made episode one. So what's all this? The extended pilot? This season zero? What's this? Moron breasts are not inherently sexual. I said moron. Fucking moron breasts are not inherently sexual. Well, no, not quite. I mean, inherently is probably too ambiguous a word, since breasts are indeed inherited, but they're not primarily sexual. But you might call them secondarily sexual. Only in the same way that beards are not inherently sexual, but they are secondarily sexual. Much like the excess fatty breast tissue that cannot contain milk, the extra hair men have on their faces has no practical function other than as markers of sexual maturity. Very obvious markers that can be seen right away and from a distance. It's nature's way of saying this one has come of age and has plenty of the necessary hormones. And indeed, in some parts of the world, like here in the West, women are disadvantaged if they don't have large breasts on display. And in some parts of the world, over there, men are advantaged by having large beards and they don't have to hide them. Did I get that right? Did I get that the right way around? Phew. Sometimes I get it wrong. Sometimes I accidentally say men are disadvantaged if they don't have large beards on display, and women are advantaged by having large breasts on display because they don't have to hide them. And my word, would all hell break loose if I were to say that, because that's obviously not true. But not that way around. Can't be. And since when was anyone hated and slandered just for telling the truth? Since when was anyone met with hysterical maladaptations from all corners of the political compass just for saying something that turned out to be true? No, it's clearly the other way around. Beards are a privilege, especially in those bad countries over there where you're expected to display them. And breasts are a burden, especially in the countries where you're expected to display them. And also in those countries where you're expected not to. Phew again, I saved it. Now everyone agrees with me, and the collective red mist of bloody straw creatures has cleared up. So I can only possibly have told the truth just now. Too long didn't listen, colon, grow the fuck up, all of you, please. What else have we got? Feminists don't always agree. They certainly don't. Sometimes feminists disagree with themselves. At one moment they'll say, "You can't judge feminists by the worst examples." The next moment they'll judge everyone who is in favour of men having rights by the example of a single anonymous troll in a comment section, or an imaginary neo-Nazi printing counterfeit keks on the red chans, or a petulant customer in a McDonald's queue, or Elliot Rodger, none of whom even have any established connection with the men's movement. You can't judge feminists based on the actions of bad feminists, but you can judge men and their rights and their advocates based on the actions of the very, very worst non-MRAs you can think of. There's another example right here, another wee twist. One moment they'll say it's wrong to dismiss fat feminists just because they're fat. And the next moment they will say, it's right to dismiss anyone you disagree with on the grounds that you suspect them of being straight, white, cisgendered men who are fat, ugly crybabies who can't get laid and have hairy armpits. I mean, hairy necks. Sorry, it's so easy to get muddled up here. But see, it's different. We know men's rights is a hate group because men's rights advocates hate women. How do we know men's rights advocates hate women? Because they're in a hate group. And in the meantime, we know feminism is about equality because it says so in the dictionary. And the dictionary says feminism is about equality because feminism is about equality. Double check and mate, sucker. Yeah, that is what we call circular reasoning. The kind and sheer scale of circular reasoning that can power a transcontinental network of sawmills from a single crank. And of course, one moment they'll say, you can't judge all Muslims by the actions of the worst of them. And the next moment they'll say, you should punch Nazis. If you see someone who looks like a Nazi or a non-feminist, that's basically the same as a Nazi, punch them in the head. Because they are a Nazi, and that means they hate Jews. But you can't just act like all Muslims are anti-Semitic. You can't tar a billion Muslims of that just because maybe two or three of them are a little bit thorny with the Jews. Speaking of understatements, it would be the understatement of the century to say feminists don't always agree. Except there is one thing they agree on, as good as all of them, as good as always, and it's women are the victims of that. Just, that's the formula for everything. Women are the victims of N, where N is anything and everything a chap can unload. Sold off the barrow, poured a barrow. Oh, this is what the prefix feminist means. Feminist history is these things happened, and women are the victims of that. Feminist geography is these things are located here, and women are the victims of that. Feminist mathematics is 2 plus 2 is 4, and women are the victims of that. Feminist politics is 2 plus 2 is 5, and women are the victims of that. And feminist string theory is everything is made of tiny 10-dimensional strings, and women are the victims of that. Feminist humanitarianism is innocent men get raped in prison, and women are the victims of that. That last one was not a joke. They actually believe that. If a man gets raped, see, then he's playing the part of a woman. Therefore, it's patriarchy in action. Therefore, women are the ultimate victims of it, so they get all his victim points. They believe it. They say that proudly in public, like it's a compassionate fucking virtue, because they genuinely believe it. Because their professors taught them to believe it. And they would. It's what naturally follows if you genuinely believe men cannot be raped. Being raped is women's work. This got out of hand a long time ago. Do you understand me? A long ass time ago. I'm not gonna wait around for them to do the same thing with murder that they did with rape. Decide it only counts if the victim is a woman. If a man gets killed by a woman, it's not murder. He was just put to sleep, you know? It's collateral damage. Not even manslaughter. He was asking for it. He enjoyed his death. I'm not going to wait until they've turned homicide into femicide before I go, okay, now they've gone too far. Now they've got rape and murder. Now let's not wait around for them to take genocide as well. It's like it's only genocide if any women die. You can kill all the men, all the boys, all the male fetuses, but it doesn't count as genocide as long as you don't inconvenience the women's while you do it. In my opinion, one is too far. Rape is too far. The complete legal gender segregation of one violent crime. It's to me an indication that this shit has already gone way too far. But yeah, I know, I'm ridiculously radical. What else have we got here? Emotion does not cancel out a good argument. I agree. So you're just angry, that's out. You're just afraid of X, that's out. You just hate X? They're right out, I'm afraid. These are all emotions, you see. And you can't just blindly declare my side represents love and your side represents fear. Because even if that were true, those are emotions and they do not cancel out, or indeed constitute by themselves, a good argument. I'm glad you brought it up. Let's see. Done that one. Done that one. How stereotypes about gender can hurt women? Oh, do you see what you've done wrong there? Oh. See, this is why I don't have to watch the video. You've only got as far as the title, and I've already spotted a mistake. Why isn't it how stereotypes about gender can hurt people? Is it because women are hurt more by stereotypes? At least according to the stereotype. How are you doing? Any lights coming on yet? No, I'll help you out. To imply, as so many of you do, or indeed to outright infer in most cases, that women are more vulnerable than men and more victimized than men in every conceivable circumstance and even several inconceivable ones, is itself a stereotype that hurts women. Very fucking obvious when you do any amount of thinking about it. If you tell your daughter that the air outside is poisonous to her, but you tell your son that the radiation from this star system will give him superpowers, then not only are you recklessly endangering your son, you are psychologically crippling your daughter. Feel free to tell them things that are true, like our society has decided it's not okay to hit a girl, but it is okay to hit a boy. That's a harsh truth, but it's important information because it's true. But don't tell them our society has decided boys are better than girls, and this has always been the case. Because it's not true. Which is rather evident by the undeniable fact we just established that we as a society give ourselves collective permission to hit boys and not girls. How the fuck is that reflective of boys are better than girls? In any meaningful or consistent sense. It means slaves are better than masters. Because they're allowed to hit them. It means dogs are better than their owners. It means punching bags are better than boxers. It's nonsense and it's a lie. It's a lie that people make up so they can continue to have an excuse to hit boys. Everything I just said, by the way, was a really good example of how stereotypes about gender can hurt men. Literally hurt them. Did you spot it? How stereotypes about gender can get boys beaten about the head and face by adult women. Because no one said anything about a female not hitting a male, or an adult not hitting a child. Nowhere in the Ten Commandments, and nowhere in the vast screeds of various feminisms. Everyone keeps forgetting to mention, hey, don't hit little boys either. And if you want to be ridiculously radical like me, don't hit men either. Mental, right? Alright, we'll move on. I like this format, actually. And I predict the audience will like it too. Because they don't have to hear your voices. And the butthurt brigade won't bitch at me for stopping the video every 5 seconds. You guys get something wrong every 5 seconds. What the fuck do you want from me? Alright, what do we have? No, Philip Moriarty isn't like that. Best mind reader ever. I was just thinking, Philip Moriarty is a rational and highly educated asset to any university faculty, but I'm glad we've cleared up that misunderstanding. Oh. Stolen llama! Oh, did you hear about Chrisiosity? She got a cease and desist letter from the estate of Roy Lichtenstein shortly after my last video came out. Now, if that was just one of you, one or more of you, and I'm guessing there's a few degrees of separation between me and my audience and the estate of Roy Lichtenstein, I should say, I don't necessarily condone that kind of perhaps underhanded, semi-censorious behaviour, but at the same time, my God, it's funny. My good gangrenous God, it's fucking funny. What happened to Baring is finally, at least in part, happening to Chrisiosity. Two wrongs don't necessarily make a right, but if there is a massive hypocrite involved, then, yeah, it's not even schadenfreude, it's just desserts. It's comedy karma going where it must go. Speaking of which, let's move on. Saying ad hominem doesn't make you sound smart. This was 3 months before you did your video, Argumentum Ad Fatum. And quite right, fancy Latin terms don't make you sound smart. Especially if you're just misapplying them to what is nothing more than an insult. There is no fancy Latin term for insult, because none is required. Actually, quite why they're required for all the other things is still unknown to me. It'd be insultatio, in case you're wondering. Or you committed an argumentum exsogratio probrum. Yes, I'm sure that does sound like a Harry Potter spell. If you're more familiar with Harry Potter than you are with Latin, which, yeah, whatever, go with the flow, I suppose. But yeah, without watching either of these videos, I could tell they probably contradict each other. Guys, you can't just call it an ad hominem every time someone insults you. By the way, you can't just call someone fat. That's argumentum ad fatum. You're playing both sides of the fallacy. That's how you're casting the straw man and the straw crow. Yeah, having your cake and eating it. I'm sure we've been here many times before. I won't make the obvious joke. Moving on. No, trans people aren't putting you in jail. Not unless I go near a Canadian university, no. Yeah, I mean, black people aren't shooting at me, but maybe that's because I'm not going to visit Compton anytime soon. But yeah, Canadian academics have made it quite clear if you go anywhere near their hood, you'd better purge your language of all gendered pronouns until further notice. Or you could face a substantial fine. And if you can't afford the fine, well, we'll just have to improvise. By the way, how the fuck are German speakers supposed to manage this? Or French speakers, or any of the languages in which most nouns are assigned a gendered pronoun? How in the shitty crikey is this supposed to translate? Are there SJWs all across Germany going, how dare you refer to that spoon as Der, die, or das. If the spoon is a neutral spoon, we will let the spoon decide. Alright, fuck, we've been here for ages. Alright, we'll do one more. What have we got? Oh. Why Muslims aren't misogynists. Oh my. Would any of the folks in the audience like to answer this question? Off the top of your heads there. Go on, work it. Figure it out. What would you say? There's something anomalous going on at this point. Ms. Ranting. A strange inversion of reasoning, if you will. See, if the title here was Why Men Aren't Misogynists, I mean, you've got one right here called Why Society Does Care About Men, which is so fucking adorable, but let's focus. If this instead said Why Men Aren't Misogynists, then the anti-feminists watching would be going, I agree, thank you for saying so. Men aren't necessarily misogynists. While the feminists watching would go, how dare you? Of course they are. If men aren't misogynists, then who on earth is? This is misogyny apology. Hey, everyone, this person thinks, parentheses, lies, lies, horseshit, horseshit, bullshit, horseshit, lies. Whereas, here's the freaky thing. All you have to do, as you did there, is swap the word men with the word Muslims. And guess what happens? You get feminists going, I agree, thank you for saying so. Muslims aren't necessarily misogynists. While you get anti-feminists going, how dare you? Of course they are. If Muslims aren't misogynists, then who on earth is? This is a misogyny apology. Hey, everyone, this person thinks parentheses lies, lies, horseshit, horseshit, bullshit, horseshit, lies. Really, it's firstly, you decide who your enemies are. And lastly, you decide they must be misogynists. You can't justify making an enemy of an entire people without convincing yourself that they are a greater threat to women than you are. It's fucking human nature. No one's ever gone to war chanting, let's get those filthy woman lovers. They're going to make life better for women than we will. We must slaughter them all. Never. Not even if it's true. Especially not if it's true. It is in this endless game of chicken and one-upmanship. Or should I say one-up womanship? One-up chickenship. Oh, no, okay. In this endless game of one-up chickenship, no one has the backbone to stop and stand up and say, actually, maybe y'all do protect women more than we do. But that's why we're better than you. Because we don't worship women to a ludicrous degree, at the expense of men's rights, and at the expense of women's agency, and at the expense of our way of life as we know it. Would you like me to answer the question? Would you like me to have a stab at it? Okay, here goes. Muslims are not misogynists because Muslims are misanthropists. Before we get into how the sets work, I should clarify how I arrived at the charge of misanthropy, because that is a serious charge. Islam does have a characteristic concern, indeed obsession, with the afterlife. There's an unmistakable preoccupation there with sacrificing as much as possible in this life for the sake of the next life, on nothing but a metaphysical promise. It's almost trivially obvious to observe that this does not translate into any sanctity in the value of human life. On the contrary, it places sanctity in the value of human death. I feel exactly the same way about reincarnation, by the way, and the apparently harmless religions that peddle that bullshit. Oh no, my people are starving and subjugated and suicidal. How did that happen? Do you think it might be because you tell them to gamble their fucking lives away? To take everything they are, everything they do, and everything they stand for and put it all on 22 red? Because 22 is a black number, dickhead. So, it seems clear to me that if a culture cares more about dead people than it cares about living people, that is a misanthropic culture. And gender is the least of their problems. Islam doesn't just hate women, it hates people. And reincarnation myths don't just hate women, they hate people. Religions like this make people waste their lives and commit suicide. Sounds fairly hateful to me. Shall we call it undesirable, if we are to be less hyperbolic? Although, correction, in practice, religions like this make men waste their lives and commit suicide, usually. The women in these cultures seem to prefer staying on in the real world to a ripe old age. No matter how fiercely they believe in martyrdom and the afterlife, they'd rather hang around in this life for as long as possible and conduct the next generation of young male suicide bombers / kamikaze pilots. Awfully fucking funny that, right? But fuck them, right? They deserve everything they get because those are actual patriarchies, right? That shit I just described, where young men kill themselves and old women tell them to and celebrate when they do. Must be patriarchy. Must be misogyny. Because my holy book. Now, regarding the logical sets, obviously, if Muslims are misanthropists and misanthropists are necessarily misandric and misogynistic, then, you know, it would not be false to say Muslims are misogynists. It would just be uninclusive. It wouldn't be false. It would just be a lie by omission. The kind of thing CNN does all the time. They only tell you half of the story because the other half of the story is inconvenient for their narrative. It's frustrating the way so many people notice this and call it out when CNN does it. And then they turn around and say, Muslims hate women. Full stop. End of story. Never to be continued. Nothing else to see here. Move along, people. Hey, guys. If you think men in the Islamic world are treated like first-class citizens, given special rights and special privileges, and they're, like, not hated, then why don't you go fucking move there? Why don't you go to an Islamic country, get yourself a house, get yourself four wives, and then put your feet up and let them do all the work? That's what happens to men in the Islamic world, right? So why don't you do that? Because you're talking shit! You fucking know you're talking shit! If you, just the average man, were in an Islamic cult country, the vaguest odds are that you will be one of the mathematically inevitable men who has zero wives and zero houses, and in all probability, the first thing they will do with you is deport you to Sweden to go live in the murder zone. And if you fuck any women while you're there, that just proves Muslims hate women. You realise what they're doing, don't you? They're giving us their convicts and their vagrants and their ne'er-do-wells. The Muslims are doing with Europe what the British Empire once did with Australia. Using it as a human trash can. And they are doing to native Europeans what we did to native Australians. Except there was only one Port Arthur massacre. And over here there's one of those every other fucking Wednesday. And you might say it's different because we weren't invited to Australia, but the Muslims are being actively invited to Europe. Well, not by me, they're not. This was not my idea. I'm just the guy stood on a rock with a didgeridoo. Like, what the fuck, mate? Is there any way I can express this democratically? Much too long, didn't listen, colon. I'm serious. Grow the fuck up. This is never going to get better unless you grow the fuck up. No country in the world, listen to me, no country in the world, no populace in the world, hates women more than it hates men. You are living in a dream world of the lowest common denominating virtue signal, and you're doing it on purpose. Islam treats women like second-class citizens, and it also treats men like second-class citizens. There is only one first-class citizen under Islam, and his name is Allah. Sorry if I misgendered you there, my non-binary gender-fluid spirit in the sky. But I'm serious, guys. If you're an anti-feminist, then quit playing feminism's fucked up little game where you pretend everything is hunky fucking dory for men, even in the third world, just so you can scare the crap out of everyone by isolating only the bad things that happen to women. Men also get raped. Men also have to dress modestly. And men also are not allowed birth control or parental surrender. And men are also not allowed to touch people with or without their permission. And men also get publicly executed for committing these transgressions. Stop pretending they don't, you goddamn Islam apologists. And please note, I enunciated very clearly just now, 5 times no less, the word also. Stop pretending that every time I say men also, I am in fact saying men are the ones who. That is not what I'm saying, you stupid, willfully bewildered fucknecks. That is what you are saying. Women are the ones who... That is the lie by omission you keep telling. In tandem with all the direct lies you are telling about anyone who dares to respond with men also, question mark. You can falsely accuse me of doing a bad thing while you are in the process of doing that exact same bad thing and calling it a good thing just because the genders are flipped. And then you have the sonic booming bitch face fucking nerve to tell me I'm just like a feminist because of my attitude to Islam. This is where feminists differ from me. Feminists will claim Islam hates no one. I will claim Islam hates everyone. So I call that a considerable difference. But here's the funny part. The average anti-feminist will claim Islam just hates women. Just hates them. Fucking hilarious state of affairs we got there, isn't it? And if you disagree with said average anti-feminist... In either direction, they say you're being just like a feminist for failing to agree that this society just hates women. Very fucked up when you think about it. Feminists believe that Islam hates no one. You know who else believes that? Muslims. So modern feminists have already become Muslims. And modern anti-feminists have already become feminists. You're witnessing the great glaciating shift of the Overton window. And as long as you're pig-headedly insisting that there must be a misogynist patriarchy out there somewhere, you are not opposing the feminists at all. You're on exactly the same track as them. You're just 30 years behind. Now, hashtag not all, obviously, including feminists. It's actually, like I said, it's mostly only the last couple of generations of academic feminists who've been taught to excuse Islam for everything. But if you ask the average feminist on the street, the middle-aged and working-class and 20th century coffee shop feminists, they're still on the same page as the so-called anti-feminists. They're like, yeah, no, of course Muslims hate women. Women are equal here, but they're still hated all over the world to this day. That's why I'm a feminist. I agree, said the anti-feminist, with everything you say. I just call myself something else. You'll never guess what. And obviously, hashtag not all feminists, not all anti-feminists either. There are some nominal anti-feminists who are indeed consistent with their principles. And they're like, yeah, no, I need you to show me what happens to both genders under the same legal and economic circumstances, or I won't accept your conclusion that this is just misogyny rather than full-on misanthropy. Now, are you going to give me the other half of the story, please? You're going to call me names and lie about me? Well, would you look at that? Such, you know, discerning folks are not even uncommon among anti-feminists. It's just that by the time people figure this out, usually they've also figured out that the trick to beating feminism is not to be anti-feminist, but simply... to advocate for men's rights. Feminists thrive on anti-feminism. It's what keeps them relevant. But men's rights is their kryptonite. They cannot coexist with it. They refuse to coexist with it, as they've demonstrated for us quite dramatically over the past few years. So just advocate inclusively for men's issues. Include men's rights in your advocacy for human rights. And that will kill everything bad about feminism if enough people do it. It really is that simple. If you can get men's rights to the table, give it the same attention and the revenue streams given to women's rights. If you can get that far, then you've already set feminism's extinction in motion. And all it takes to achieve this, friends, all it takes to include men's rights in your advocacy for human rights is... You know, when someone asks you, are you a human rights advocate, you say, yes. When someone asks you, are you a women's rights advocate, you say, yes. Well, hold on tight. When someone asks, are you a men's rights advocate, you say, yes. Instead of suddenly changing your go-to answer to, no, I don't like groups or labels or identity politics. Have I changed my answers to questions 1 and 2? No, no, sir, I have not. I am a human rights advocate and I am a women's rights advocate, but I am not a men's rights advocate because I don't like identity politics. What? I don't see the problem here. All you need to do is say yes. Instead of saying all that shit. You can't do it. You can't just say men also. You have to drift off into upside down land and recite this self-refuting gobbledygook. And you think it's okay because all your friends are doing it too. Because you're still under the spell. The spell where men are bad and women are weak and men's rights is never good enough and women's rights is never strong enough. You don't know what the world would look like if you got over the spell. And it's scary. I can understand that. It's just as scary as letting go of God. Not just all the other gods that you never believed in, but letting go of your own God as well. The moment you go, oh shit, there's no God. Not even my favourite one. It's just nature. It's just me and my fellow creatures and the infinite beauty of nature. Wait, I just believed. I just realised nature is infinitely beautiful all by itself. Well, snap. And should your eyes remain open, another moment comes. The moment you go, oh shit, there's no misogynist patriarchy. Anywhere. Not even that one over there, the one I really, really want to believe in. Anyone with a quarter ass of an education and a modicum of intellectual honesty knows. Any culture that callously disposes of women and sacrifices their health and well-being in favour of men's can only exist for a blink of her historical eye before they are destroyed and consumed by all the other cultures around them. The ones that dogmatically protect and provide for women at the expense of men's lives and well-being. Because that is the model on which Homo sapiens has laid its success consistently over the millennia. As long as women are the limiting factor in reproduction, as long as the size of the next generation depends on the number of women still alive and healthy in the previous generation, and we are still hardwired to operate under those conditions, this is always going to be the case, that men are sacrificed for the good of women. An actual patriarchy, as described by everyone who believes in it, in which women are sacrificed for the good of men, is in reality as impossible and unsustainable as an all-female tribe of Amazon warriors. It's a fun idea. It's a visually and philosophically interesting thing to write graphic novels about, but it is fictional. Can you honestly tell me that Islam, right here in non-fictional reality, Islam managed to grow a civilization of over 1 billion people, right in the middle of the risk board, and have held on to it for over 1,000 years, on the back of history's one exception to this rule, by sacrificing women's well-being and protection so that men could fuck around and have a good time or some shit? Bollocks. They sacrifice women's freedom for their protection as they equally and oppositely sacrifice men's protection for their freedom, so-called. If this is misogyny, then all of human history is a litany of eternal misogyny. You are free to believe that if you like, but I think we all know whose company you'll be standing in if you believe that. Far too long didn't listen, colon. Grow the ever-living fuck up, please. Until you snap out of it, until you get over this shit, every stone you throw at feminism is from inside a glass house. You're all Highnesses. Once again, we're hungry for a lynching. Mistake to make. You should turn the other cheek. Well, of course, I'd like to stay around and chew the fat. But someone's listening.